Hello, I'm Kirsty Young, and this is a podcast from the Desert Island Discs archive. For rights reasons, we've had to shorten the music. The programme was originally broadcast in 2007. My castaway this week is Ricky Gervais. In just 12 episodes, his show The Office changed the face of British television comedy, laying waste to the traditional sitcom props of implausible characters, overblown punchlines and phony laughter tracks. In David Brent, he created the perfect comedy anti-hero, marooned among the concrete and photocopiers of Slough, a risible company drone drowning in management speak and self-delusion, his toe-curling performance making excruciatingly compulsive viewing. With 7 BAFTAs, 2 Golden Globes, sell-out stand-up tours and now a thriving Hollywood career, his place in the British Comedy Hall of Fame is guaranteed. Whether he'll want to be there is another question. He is notably scathing about the celebrity culture of our time and uncommonly forthright in his views of fellow performers. Ricky Gervais, empathy, you've said, is the very nub of human interaction. How much do you empathise with David Brent?
Quite a lot, really, because I think we've all got a little bit of David Brentness. We all want to be loved. We're all worried about how we're perceived. And we've all got the blind spot. I think it's monstrous in David Brent. But by definition, we never know about our own blind spot.
David Brent has become a massive cultural figure. I mean, people sort of quote him and they do impersonations of him. For the very few people who are unaware of who he is, can you describe the character?
He's middle everything. He's middle management, middle England. He's going through a bit of a midlife crisis. He's a man in free fall. I mean, his worst crime, I suppose, is that he's confused popularity with respect. And, the shortcut to popularity is fame. And he's not a bad man at all. He's a bit of a twit.
When it first came onto our screens, The Office, that is, people weren't entirely sure, certainly at least for the first few minutes, whether it was another one of these reality shows or whether it was a comedy. I mean, such was its realism. How did you know? I mean, presumably that had come from your own experience of working in dull, repetitive, grey offices.
Well, I worked in an office for 7 years, and obviously I've always been quite a people watcher. And the reason why it had to be so real, hyper-real, is that, you know, it was essential that people understood this was meant to be a documentary. Because without that aspect, it's nothing. It's a bunch of idiots in an office where nothing happens. But if you say he's doing this to become famous, it all falls into place. Everything makes sense then.
It made you incredibly famous, of course. I would guess that you started getting people shouting at you in the street and doing the David Brent funny dance and all of that stuff. How does that sit with you?
Well, you know what? People don't really. The people that, approach me are very respectful. And it was more my own phobia fame than, it was actually terrible. It's not that bad and I can't whinge, but it didn't make sense to me. The worrying thing more and more is that people don't really know the difference between someone who appears in Hollyoaks and someone who invents a cure for cancer. That's the problem. They did a survey, a university survey recently amongst 10-year-olds, and they asked them what they wanted to be when they grew up, and they said famous. Not even a footballer, not even a model, just famous, that'll do. And I think it's the shortcut. They see George Clooney and they go, he's happy and all those things, and they don't realise that he's happy because he does something well and he's got a body of work and he's got pride in what he does, and they see him waving on the red carpet and they think, they jump straight to the red carpet waving. No, that's not the happy bit. That's him at work.
Tell me about your first record then.
Well, the first one I've chosen is Bob Dylan, If You See Her, Say Hello. I remember when I was probably about 10, I've got older brothers and sisters, and my sister's about 14 years older than me, so she was about 24. And my brother-in-law, Graham, brought all his old records to my mum's house. I saw them when they were there in the spare room. And I remember once, I was really into biology and chemistry at this age, and this guy had all these chemicals from his chemistry sets, and he was really into Elvis. And he said, oh, I'll swap you some chemicals for one of those Elvis. What a nerd I was. And so I did, and then it got too much for me, and I woke up in a sweat that night, and I went into my mum's room, and I said...
Then you grew up in, it was Reading, quite nearby.
Very close, yeah.
What was home life like?
Fine, yeah. As I said, I had older brothers and sisters.
They were quite a lot older.
Yeah, my next brother was 11 years older. I had the best and worst of it, really.
How did they treat you then as much older siblings?
Well, I was spoiled and bullied, so it was a perfect balance. I suppose I had to shout to be heard, so that's the classic show-off performer in me. But it was very normal, I think. I mean, I didn't know that we were poor till I went to university and people spoke like the Queen. I grew up in a working-class estate. My dad was a labourer. My mum was a housewife with part-time jobs. Fairly typical, hard-working, working-class family, yeah.
That great story you told before we heard the first record about your mother saying, you know, using the fact that you'd given away one of the records that were in fact yours. I mean, to any mother, that just sounds like the most brilliant technique. But she obviously had a fair idea of how to keep you in line. She was quite a strong woman.
I think normal mothers would have said, God's watching you, but I was already an atheist by the age of 10. It was funny because I was about 8 or 9 years old, and I used to go to Sunday school, and I believed in God, of course, you know. And I remember once I was doing a drawing from the Bible, and my older brother came in, Bob, and went, "What are you doing?" I said, "I'm just doing Jesus." He went, "Well, why do you believe in God?" And my mum went, "Bob." And I knew. I knew he had something to tell me, and she didn't want him to. So,
how did that sit with your mother? I mean, if she had felt that it was important for you to go to Sunday school, presumably she was religious.
Well, not really. I think it was to a hard-working, working-class mother, Jesus and God were cheap babysitters. If I'm not watching you, they are. And it just helps them out around the home.
And for you, you were saying that you were fascinated by science as a wee boy, so facts were the thing for you. That could be proven. You were quite a sensible boy.
Well, yes, I wasn't a bad boy. I didn't used to, you know, pull frogs apart and set fire to buildings. I was cheeky. I answered back. So the biggest chance of me getting into trouble was acting cleverer than the teacher. That was the high risk for me. But yeah, I absolutely was fascinated with science and nature. I always knew I'd go to university. I wanted to study science. I was a keen sort of scientist, and I was in awe of the world. I was just absolutely in awe of the world.
More of that in a moment. Tell me about your second record.
This is Cat Stevens and Lily White. The first album I ever bought was Teaser and the Firecat. This track is off of Tea for the Tillerman. And this one, Lily White, is just beautiful. Taking time to check down. Thank Lily White, I never knew her name. She'll be passing my way sometime. My way sometime again.
Cat Stevens and Lily White. Tell me then, Ricky Gervais, was there a sort of family sense of humour? I mean, I know you didn't want to overplay the idea of sort of poverty and we didn't have much, but one of the things that can bind working class families together especially is a lot of laughs.
That was the most important thing. Outside having a job, you know, you had to have a job. Didn't matter what you earned, but you had to have a job. If you had a job, you were allowed to have a laugh. That was what it was all about.
Was there a sense of competitiveness in the humour? I mean, did somebody always want to be the one who got the last line in?
Yeah, but you respected if you had a go. If you crumbled, you'd lost. And if you came out with a good one, it could be devastating, but they'd have to laugh. You know, it was an engagement and you'd shake hands afterwards and go, good one.
Who set the tone for that? Was it your father?
No, my father was very dry. He said, you know, one thing a day. But I suppose my next oldest brother, Bob, was the one that instigated most things. He was just said funny things, you know, there's nowhere he wouldn't go.
What about boundaries? Because between people who know each other very well, of course, you can go where people don't normally go, people you don't know as well. You know, you can just take the humour to places that might be considered a bit risky.
Well, when my mum died, we were organising the funeral, and my... The vicar said to my brother, "So tell me about your mother. What was she like?" And my brother, just winding up the vicar, said, "She was a keen racist." And the vicar said, "What? Well, I can't say that." He went, "Oh, OK, then she liked gardening." And then when we were at the funeral, so there's me, my brother Bob, my sister Marsha, and our oldest brother, Larry, who'd come down from Scotland. But my brother had played a trick on him as well, because
the vicar suddenly goes, Ava leaves behind four loving children, Ricky, Bob, Marsha and Barry. And Larry just turns around and looks for, and we're crying with laughter. And the vicar thinks we're crazy, that we're there crying and crying with laughter.
But apart from, I mean, there is a question about whether or not, of course, we use humour as a reflex to protect us from things, and where more than a funeral are you going to feel the pain of a parent dying? But also, I mean, for me, I find those very funny stories. For a lot of people, though, there, you've strayed into the bounds of absolute tastelessness and disrespect.
But definitely not. But absolutely...
Definitely not, because everybody is participating. In
Everyone, you know, knew what they thought of Mum, and we were worried about what the vicar thought.
Right.
I remember, I think it was at my dad's funeral, where we're mucking around and laughing, and Bob had to go over to the vicar and say, sorry about that. He said, you know, he was 83. If he was 50, there'd have been less laughter. And that sums it up. You know, he'd had a good life, and it was exactly what they would have wanted, I think.
The stuff that you were saying about your mother's funeral, though, there's very much a sense in which that reflects the idea that there is nowhere you won't go for laugh. I mean, is that for you also a professional dictum, that wherever you think you will make people smile, that is where you're willing to travel for a joke or a good line?
Well, yes, but you've got to be, you know, I wouldn't do it at someone else's mum's funeral. You know, I think that's the difference. But I don't think there's any taboos in humour. It's where the humour comes from. Humour comes from a good or a bad place.
So context is all.
Of course. Of course. Yeah.
Tell me about your third record.
This is The Sex Pistols and Anarchy in the UK. When Nevermind the Bollocks came out, I couldn't believe it. I ran home from school and played it every single night for about 6 months. And the opening line, I am an antichrist. I am an anarchist. You know, I was just the right age to get excited about this sort of thing. But it stands up. It's such a powerful song. I think it's great.
The Sex Pistols and Anarchy in the UK, and memories there of playing that every night, you said, for 6 months.
Yeah.
Dene Gervais, when you got home from school. I mean, you were quite a musical person. You liked the idea of being in a band. You formed a band.
I loved music. I started playing guitar because of Cat Stevens, and then when I went to university, I joined a band.
You would have been what age then? It was called Shauna Dancing.
Yeah, I was, 20, and... When it was all over, I was still 20.
I've seen a little clip of a video. I mean, you cut a bit of a dash, didn't you? You were.
Yeah, that's right.
So well,
people
you did.
People show me pictures of me when I was 19, and I go, oh, no, and they think that I'm embarrassed the way I used to look. No, I'm embarrassed how I look now. I'm jealous of how I used to look. It depresses me. I was 6 stone lighter. I had a jawline. Yeah. Incredible.
Quite a lot of gel going on in the hair, it looked to me, or some sort of mousse or something.
Quite a lot of hair.
Quite a lot of hair.
Those were the days.
Bit of eyeliner.
I've still kept my hair, actually. It was New Romantic days, a lot of eyeliner. And obviously, I had to sound like David Bowie.
And can you remember any of the lyrics from any of the songs? I just saw what flashed through your eyes there. You can, but you're not sure you want to say them.
That's exactly right.
Go on, then.
No, you were right. I can, but I'm not going to say them.
Why not?
Because... It makes me want to crawl into a dustbin.
And I notice you haven't chosen any Shauna Dancing for us here today.
That's weird, isn't it? Yeah. Imagine if I had.
So why did you leave behind your ideas of pop stardom and musicianship?
I didn't leave them behind. I failed miserably and had to do something else.
But some people plug away for years even though they fail.
Well, I did half-heartedly for a little while, but then I thought I'd better get a proper job and have a change of career. And so I went on to the periphery of entertainment, and I became an ENTS manager. You know, I managed bands and I dabbled and I, you know, still produced bits and pieces.
And you said the important thing in your family was that first base was having a job, secondary it was to make jokes. So what did your parents make of the fact that you were dabbling in
Well, that was it. I broke the rules there a little bit because I held out trying to, you know, chase a dream for longer than I probably should have. I went home one Christmas and I went, oh, yeah, I meant to tell you. I want to join a band. And we actually had just got a record deal. We got it very quickly. And she went, rock star is another word for junkie, right? And I told her the advance and she went, Mick Jagger bought his mouse in Wales.
I really like the sound of your mother. Tell me about your next track.
This is Neil Young, After the Gold Rush. His voice is so fragile. It's like he's worried about what he's got to tell you, but he's going to tell you anyway. After the Gold Rush, there's a lyric in there, look at Mother Nature on the run in the 1970s.
As you said, Ricky, you had been an entertainments officer. That was sort of that was your job for quite some time.
Probably about 89 to 97.
And this was the office work, really.
That was the last 2 or 3 years I was there. We moved upstairs to an open plan office, which the office is based on.
And you worked in a radio station, which was where you met Stephen Merchant.
Right? Exactly. When I left that job as the ants manager, I'd been offered a job at the fledgling radio station, XFM, and I was allowed an assistant, and I think Steve's CV was at the top of the pile, and he wanted to be a stand-up comedian. He was starting out in stand-up. I suppose I thought, well, I'll show him I'm funny. And I had a character called CD Boss, and then when Steve went to the BBC to do a trainee production course, he had one day with a film crew, and he said, let's film that character. And it turned out a little 20-minute office.
And so Stephen Merchant, of course, is your co-creator and co-writer. He directed both series and wrote them along with you and also stars in the extras as your useless agent. Did you know when you saw it that you had a little bit of gold dust, or did they know?
I knew it was different. We were low risk. It didn't cost much. And, you know, it went out in July at 9:30 on a Monday. So they probably thought, what's the worst that can happen?
Tell me about your next piece of music.
The next track is Radiohead, Bones. There's a lyric that goes, I used to fly like Peter Pan. And the way he sings it and the way the music soars, it brings a lump to my throat because it's that anything to do with regrets or the way things were, I'm a sucker for that. And this, it just does something to my soul. It makes me well up. This is Radiohead and Bones.
Radiohead and Bones, and you said the line in there, Ricky Gervais, that touches you most is, I used to fly like Peter Pan.
I know, isn't that sad?
Well, you seem like quite a sort of romantic soul under it all.
Yeah, we're just here for as long as we're here, and I just think that's sad. It's probably because I'm an atheist. This is all we've got, so you better enjoy it.
And you better leave behind something that matters.
Yeah, well, I do think like that. You know, in the work, I'm conscious of the legacy. I do want this work to be as good in 20 years as it is now, or whatever. And I do want to leave something behind, really.
Those are very high ideals, aren't they? Because a lot of people are just delighted to be working in television or films, or just delighted to get paid for it. And your ideals seem much higher than that. You're determined that it's going to be art.
Yeah, I always worry about a fat little comedian from Reading even saying the word art. That's how we're brought up in Britain, isn't it? That we're worried about being pretentious or above our station. So, if I'm being honest, yeah, I do. I think there's nothing wrong with putting the art into comedy. There's nothing wrong with that.
And maybe also something of all of those values that were ingrained in you as a little boy, the idea that if this is going to be your job, and it's a bit of an odd job compared to what most people do, I mean, it is not what your father did, it's not going out and sweating blood every day.
Absolutely.
Being a labourer on a building site. Yeah. It is, in a sense, a bit of a non-job. Therefore, you've got to make it good to get over the guilt.
Absolutely, yeah. I went through a period of guilt just having a nice life, you know. It's not guilt, it's why can't everyone have what I've got? That I suppose it's different to guilt.
How does that manifest itself then? That sort of slightly shameful feeling that you're getting away with something that other people should share.
That's exactly it. That I'm getting away with something that everyone should share. I don't know what to do about it, really. All I have to do is know that if you're not proud of that you're rich, then at least you're not ashamed of it. You know, I haven't hurt anyone to do this. And I remember I was offered a couple of adverts and a couple of corporates. And the reason I did it was because the first one I was offered was my dad's salary for 20 minutes. And I felt guilty about doing it. I didn't want to do it. But then I thought I felt guilty about not doing it because who was I to turn down? And I did a couple and I thought, no, I don't want to do this. I don't want it. I don't like it. So I've never regretted saying no. In fact, for the first few months, it sort of ruined it a bit. I was so proud of the office. It's the thing I tried hardest at in my life, and I got 10 out of 10. And I realised that that meant more to me than anything else. And when the royalty checks came in, it ruined it a bit. I just didn't want to talk about it. I'm over it now.
Banking the checks? Tell me about your next piece of music.
David Bowie. Probably my single biggest hero in music. And I suppose he's known for putting the art into music. But what people don't realise is he's written one of the most beautiful love songs ever. It's called Letter to Hermione, and it's just so stripped down. This is just gorgeous. And when he's strong for you. And when you kiss, it's something new. But did you ever call my name just by mistake? I'm not quite sure what I'm supposed to do, so I'll just write some love to you.
David Bowie and Letter to Hermione. And you say it is Bowie and not Bowie, because, of course, you've met the man.
Oh,
himself.
Yeah, me and Dave are like that.
You are actually friends now,
it's
aren't
Bowie.
You?
Well, we are now, yeah, I suppose so. I remember the first time I met him, it was just soon after The Office broke. I went along to see one of those sort of VIP concerts for radio or something, and I went along with my girlfriend. And afterwards, we went in the green room, and Greg Dyke, then the head of BBC, bounced over and said, "You're a Bowie fan, aren't you?" I went, "Yeah." He went, "Do you want to meet him?" I went, "What? Isn't he sort of just chilling out?" "No, come on, we're going to meet him." And so me, my girlfriend, Greg Dyke, went down to Bowie's dressing room. On the way, Greg Dyke shouts, "Salman!"
That'd be Rushdie.
That'll be, yes. Salman Rushdie. So we're all in his dressing room. We met him and he said hello and was chatting to us. And the next day in the pub, my mate went, "What did you do last night?" And I went, "Nothing." What could I say? I hung out with Salman Rushdie, David Bowie and Greg Dyke. Why? What did you do?
In extras, of course, you've used David Bowie. He sang Little Fat Man, was it Sold His Soul, about a comedy writer.
See
and
his pug-nosed face. What a sing-along lyric that is.
And you sat there manfully and took it from your hero. Also, Robert De Niro, Kate Winslet. I mean, a host of extraordinary stars you've had in. And it is about this man who is what they call a supporting artist. He never has anything to say on set, but he has a regular paid job as an extra. And then he does find fame. Mm. Now, contrasting that with The Office, of course, you worked in this office for many years.
Yeah.
It will become increasingly difficult, won't it, for you to cull your material from reality, because your reality becomes compromised by your fame.
Well, yeah, you know, my English teacher said, write about what you know. So I think it's the first album's easy because it's all your year's experience, and the second album's the last year, which probably wasn't a normal year. So yes, but
and extras came from that. Did it? Extras came from these extreme brushes of standing with Salman Rushdie and David Bowie?
Well, you know, just having your life changed. You know, I don't want it to sound like whinging. Everyone's polite. You know, it's not like I go out into the street and I'm bothered, or I live in the centre of London. No one really bats an eyelid, and it's cool. But it was creepy. You know, I think when the first BAFTA was creepy because there was press, you know, ringing my doorbell, and I thought, well, how do they know where I live? Why do they care? I didn't sign that deal with the devil. I didn't call the press up and say, I'm going to be at the airport. I didn't get a PR person going, there's this new comedian. I didn't do that. And so, and to be fair to the press, they're totally respectful. They know that they're not going to catch me falling out of China Whites with a slapper on my arm. They know I don't do it. There's no story there.
Tell me about your next piece of music.
Jimmy Webb. Now, a lot of people won't know who Jimmy Webb is. They probably know his work. He wrote all the hits for Glen Campbell. He wrote MacArthur Park. He wrote Up, Up and Away. And this is a version of Galveston. And it's absolutely beautiful. It's a guy who leaves to go to war. And there's a lyric in there that goes, I'm so afraid of dying before I dry the tears she's crying. And it's just lyrics like that. This is Galveston.
Galveston, oh Galveston, I still hear your sea winds blowing, I still see her dark eyes glowing. She was 21 when I left Galveston.
Jimmy Webb and Galveston. 25 years now, you've lived with your partner, Jane. I mean, you met while you were both students.
That's right.
She is a very successful television producer and now a writer.
Yeah.
It's an extraordinary journey that she's been on with you. How has she handled it? I mean, the fame and the notoriety and the working in Hollywood and all those things you do now.
It seems like a very sort of, I don't know, it just seems very natural to us because we know nothing's changed except our bank balance and when you step outside the door. We haven't changed our values or our outlook or our politics or our, you know, beliefs at all.
And I've read that you like to live this very sort of quiet, domesticated life, that you used to have a cat called Colin no longer around, that you're in bed by 9:30. Is all that stuff true?
Well, sort of. Yeah, we've got a cat now called Ollie, and I'm in my pyjamas by 6 p.m. I do my work, and I come home and I'm in front of the telly, and I'm watching Big Brother. When I'm away and I'm working, I miss being on the couch with a bottle of wine, watching telly and stroking the cat.
And your family life sounded like a very happy and vibrant one, but you don't fancy children. That's not something you've chosen for yourself.
No. That's a conscious decision. It's just those first 16 years. I don't want to go through that. I worry about the cat getting out. If I had a baby, I'd watch it all night. I couldn't sleep. Also, they don't give you anything back. Babies, they're scroungers. They do nothing.
Tell me about your last piece of music.
This is, well, first of all, it's an absolutely beautiful song. And it's always on my mind. And the Elvis version's beautiful. But I never considered Elvis vulnerable enough to pull this song off like Willie Nelson. Again, it's that regret. It's that guy who's maybe made some mistakes and now he's in the twilight years. And he's trying to put it right. This one, out of all the songs, nearly makes me cry every time.
I'm so happy that you're mine. Little things I should have said and done, I just never took the time. When you were always on my mind,
Willie Nelson and Always on My Mind, rich with sentimentality and regret.
The worst thing about that is it's too late.
To do anything about it, you mean?
Well, yeah. You know, you can improve and get a second chance, but you can't have it back. That's the terrible thing. Oh, I've brought the whole tone down. Sorry about this. Here's the Sex Pistols.
No, it isn't. I'll give you the Bible and the complete works of Shakespeare to take onto this island. You might not want the Bible, of course. Would you like to read it anyway? Or?
No, the paper might become useful.
Okay. You get to take a book with you. What will your book be?
I don't know. So the point of it's not being referenced is that so it's no... it doesn't help me in any way. You know, it's not about poison plants or how to build a boat.
Exactly.
So I could take a tabletop book of, like, works of art.
Yes.
I'll do that.
We allow you to a luxury to make life a little more bearable on the island. What would your luxury be?
Oh, this is so difficult. What about painkillers and things like that, like
yes, you can
like
take
Novocaine and
yes.
stuff like that. How much morphine could I take? A vat?
Yes.
I could take a vat of morphine?
Yes.
Well, I don't really care about the island then, will I? But medicine's useful. Why can I take morphine and Novocaine and stuff like that?
Because they're not going to cure you, so they're only so useful. I mean, they might kill the pain of loneliness, but they're not going to cure you of anything.
OK, I'll take a vat of Novocaine.
That you may have. And
that was Ricky Gervais, the atheist drug addict.
I'm going to force you to save just one track. If you were only allowed one, which one would it be?
I'm on a desert island, which I'm taking into account. I think Cat Stevens, Lily White.
Ricky Gervais, thank you very much for letting us hear your desert island discs.
My pleasure.
You've been listening to a podcast from the Desert Island Discs archive. For more podcasts, please visit bbc.co.uk/radio4.